So in fifth grade, I used to get in trouble for talking loud, and now y'all are like, speak up. The circle of life is beautiful. Thank you for having me here today, and I want to say that I think that this is very fitting that we're at the Lee County School District Education Center, because the Latin root of the word doctor is actually teacher. Disclosures, I don't really have any disclosures to give. I'm employed by Lee Health. I don't receive money through pharmaceuticals. Every talk that I give, I always put a picture of my kids to remind me why I do what I do. So as Dr. Sal mentioned, I'm a member of the Institute for Functional Medicine, and this past year I had a great opportunity to go to the annual international conference where I presented on sleep medicine and kind of making a bridge between sleep medicine and functional medicine. And their topic was on modifiable lifestyle factors. And I've taken bits and pieces of some of the information that I've learned to present to y'all today. So our objectives is we are going to talk about the science of how rest, movement, nutrition affect our lifestyle, affect our health. I'm going to put a special emphasis on insulin resistance. I'm also going to touch on inflammation and cancer. I'm going to spend some time talking about the role of glycemic index, and I'm going to encompass both adult and pediatric aspects. Out of scope, I'm not going to talk about individual sleep disorders. I did that 2 years ago with the National Speaker Series, and we have that on YouTube, and I'd be happy to share that link with you. And also, I'm just going to brush on mitochondrial dysfunction, neurological disorders, and mental health, because likewise, I gave that talk last year, and we have that on YouTube, and if anyone wants the link, I'll be happy to send it to you. So, conventional medicine. And we start out with health. In conventional medicine, we start out with health, and then things occur. Antecedents, triggers, and mediators occur. Sometimes we don't always address these, and we'll get symptoms. We end up with a diagnosis, and then we have a treatment, either a medication or a surgery. Now, if we don't address those antecedents, triggers, and mediators, we continue on these treatments, and then we can get side effects, additional diagnosis, sometimes more meds or more surgery. And then we end up with disease progression, more disease, and ultimately death. Is this a broken approach? So what if we were to take those antecedents, triggers, and mediators and get down to the root causes, the form wellness? The root causes are lifestyle factors that include poor diet, lack of sleep, sedentary lifestyle, and stress. We all feel stress. And these are true for adults as they are for kids as well. Lifestyle causes chronic disease, but lifestyle also prevents and reverses chronic disease. Dr. Chazal, who's the president of the American College of Cardiology, made a really great point that last year when we talked about food as medicine, that we did a lot of observational studies, and his good point was that we need more clinical trials. And that's true. But let's just talk about evidence-based medicine in general. So when people say the word evidence-based medicine, many doctors think of a double-blind, placebo, clinical control trial. And that is the gold standard for a medication. Once you've developed a disease, you test that medication against a sugar pill, which by the end of my talk, you're going to think that sugar pills are unethical. But what is evidence-based medicine? Evidence-based medicine is taking the best external evidence that you have. You use your own individual clinical expertise and take into account patient values and expectations. That is evidence-based medicine. We have long used the word medicine to be synonymous for health. One definition of medicine is the art of science, the art or science of restoring or preserving health. Well, food is medicine. And we know that because even Hippocrates said, "Let food be thy medicine and medicine be thy food." Well, guess what? Exercise is medicine too. In fact, the term medicine ball was coined in 1889 by Professor Roberts He turned the term medicine ball in reference to the fact that using the ball invigorates the body to promote digestion, restore, and preserve one's health. And what about the symbol of medicine? Asclepius in the ancient Greek religion was the god of medicine, and his symbol remains the symbol of medicine today. He walked around these temples with a staff, and there were these non-venomous snakes that were around there, and the sick and the injured, they came not for medications, but they came there for rest. So let's start there. The Flammarion engraving represents cosmology. There's a rhythm to life. You see the night leaving and the sun rising. Well, there's a rhythm to sunspots. There's a rhythm to gravitational pools and tides. There's a rhythm to atmospheric pressure. There's a rhythm to temperatures. It's colder in the morning, it's warmer in the evening, and if you know, Florida does not participate in winter. There's a rhythm to the cosmos, and Dr. Jeff Bland talks about how these environmental rhythms trigger different receptors that we have within our body to form biological rhythms. Now, what exactly are we doing to these biological rhythms in our 24-hour go, go, go society? Talk about endocrine disruptors. Integrative medicine, Dr. Heather Hall is going to talk about endocrine disruptors, of which our broken circadian patterns do that. And guess what? There's a ripple effect that's causing this to get worse as time goes by. What does all of this light activity do to our sleep? It has us depleted. And in fact, America is not sleeping. 35% of Americans get less than 7 hours of sleep per night, and this problem is even worse with teenagers. If you take a map and you look at the most sleep-deprived areas, you're going to see that this overlaps with the maps of obesity. Want to make America great again? America needs sleep. Now, sleep problems are on the rise. Diagnosis of insomnia are increasing. Diagnosis of sleep apnea have gone up 442%. Awareness is one of them, absolutely. But also our increase of obesity is contributing to this as well. And then the market for sleep medications used to be a $5 million industry. It's now a $20 million industry, of which medications are actually not first-line therapy for insomnia. The American Academy of Sleep Medicine has been saying for years cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia is effective, but now even the American College of Physicians say that cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia, CBTI, is first line. So if a doctor writes for a sleep aid without referring to psychologists for CBTI, you know, it's kind of the equivalent of starting metformin without never having referred to a dietitian or even talked nutrition. Speaking of which, sleep, lack of sleep, affects insulin resistance through many modalities. And obstructive sleep apnea, short sleep time, circadian rhythm disturbances, this causes sympathetic stress. It causes oxidative stress. It causes inflammatory cytokine changes that lead to insulin resistance. By the way, if you order a sleep study, especially just the home sleep studies, just looking for sleep apnea only, and then if it comes back negative, say, okay, everything's fine, you're missing other sleep disorders. So practicing providers out there, physicians and providers, I would recommend that you refer to sleep medicine as opposed to just ordering sleep studies or sending to a pulmonologist. Why is this important? Because sleep is intertwined with many things, sleep and inflammation. It's been shown that this is bidirectional, that lack of sleep increases inflammatory markers, but likewise, treatments that require inflammation also cause sleep disturbances, and sleep disturbances with autoimmune disorders are very interrelated as well. Sleep and cancer. Both short sleep time and long sleep time have both been associated with cancer. The long sleep time may be because people are sick, so they're sleeping more, but also patients with cancer have more fatigue, of which they have increased sleep disturbances that could be contributing to this. And when they take cancer patients and they do a meta-analysis on mind-body interventions, their sleep improves and their overall outcome improves as well. There's even rhythms in treatment, okay? So it's been shown that administration of chemotherapy in the morning resulted in improved median survival time when given compared to those that also receive chemotherapy without the timing to be in the morning. So an improved chronosynchronization achieved through program exercise, meal timing, light exposure, and sleep schedule improves quality of life and overall cancer survival. We have a rhythm. Melatonin comes out in the evening. Our gut slows down. We wake up. We have different rhythms within our gut during the day. We have these biological rhythms. And there's this interplay with our microbiome and our circadian clocks. So disruption of clock gene expression through changes in the light and dark cycle was found to alter our microbiome. And interesting, when you give probiotics, you actually help with melatonin production. So we used to think, we still do think, that melatonin is made in the pineal body, but that's like saying serotonin is made in the brain. To say that melatonin is in the brain is like saying serotonin is in the brain. 10% of your body's serotonin is in your brain. The other 90% is in your gut. Well, melatonin is used throughout your body as well, including through the electron transport chain of mitochondrial, in our mitochondria, in complex 1 and complex 4. Every cell in our body has mitochondria. So eating this can cause this, disrupted circadian clocks, imbalanced gut bacteria. And I don't have time to talk about leaky gut, but what I will say is naturopathic consultant Teresa Spano is going to talk about this, but my one comment about leaky gut is that your gut is not like Vegas, okay? What happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. Your gut is like Facebook. What happens there goes viral and it spreads. But this brings up a good time to talk about electronics and sleep. People ask me all the time, what do I think about electronics and sleep? Well, one obvious answer is take a look at the amount of light that's disrupting your circadian rhythm. That's an obvious answer. The not so obvious answer is electromagnetic frequency. Why is it that people sleep better when they go camping? Why is it that I constantly see people wake up before their alarm clock, constantly, but when the power goes off, they sleep past that time that they normally would? In electromagnetic frequency, we have these different wavelengths, and at different wavelengths, we alter different functions. Mitochondria needs calcium. Every cell in your body has mitochondria. The mitochondria make energy. And at a certain wavelength, we alter calcium flow. And EMF activation of voltage-gated calcium channels increases free radical production. And commonly reported neuropsychiatric symptoms following EMF exposure, insomnia is one of them. And among electronic repair workers, they found changes in oxidative stress, melatonin levels, as well as sleep insufficiencies. What is all this Wi-Fi, what is all of this EMF frequency doing to our brains? I don't know. We don't have those answers, but we should watch out for this. We should watch it. We should keep our cell phones at a certain distance. We should spare some screen time. One of the problems is that we're bringing it closer and closer to us. So electronic devices is a good time to talk about stress. Why? Because 1 in 5 Americans never engage in any stress reduction activities, and when they do, it's TV or internet. Then there's the work-life balance. 85% of people who work, when they go home, they continue to work at least one time a week. I'm guilty. And then there's overtime. You know, working overtime, it can be a booby trap. And serious subject, when you work more, it's been associated with increased rates of cancer. So I'm not telling y'all not to work, but I'm saying, what are we doing to counteract that? The heart and stress. The more you work, the more risk factor that you have for cardiovascular disease and stroke. So what are we doing? That's where meditation comes in. Meditation allows us to calm our mind. It calms the sympathetic stress by activating our parasympathetic response. The other thing that it helps to do is build empathy as well. And it builds your brain. The neurologist in me is talking. Mindfulness practice leads to increased brain matter density. That's powerful. I talked last year about how exercise increases BDNF, brain-derived neurotrophic factor, which is growth hormone for your brain. Well, Meditation does too. Meditation reduces cortisol, elevates BDNF, and also lowers oxidative stress. And it's good for inflammation as well. A long-term practice of meditation may reduce stress reactivity and could be therapeutic benefit in chronic inflammatory conditions characterized by neurogenic inflammation. It helps your heart as well. Multiple studies have demonstrated the beneficial effects on the heart. And meditation has also been shown to improve conditions such as high blood pressure, type 2 diabetes, dyslipidemia, and cortisol levels. So when my daughter, when her preschool, VPK, was learning about the heart, I volunteered to come in. Why? Not because I'm a cardiologist, I'm not. I'm a neurologist and a sleep specialist. Because I saw that as an opportunity to teach them how to meditate. And this is pretty cool. I didn't realize this until I was putting this talk together. I'm meditating on a lotus pond. You see the lily pads and frogs there. Switching gears, movement. Nothing has the power to transform like movement. The problem is that Americans are pretty inactive. 80% do not receive the recommended exercise. And we think of obesity as being this great risk factor, but actually sedentary lifestyle is a bigger risk factor for mortality than obesity. Sitting is the new smoking. If anybody wants to stand during the rest of my lecture, I won't care. TV time. It's been shown that the more TV time you have, the more risk factor that you have for all causes of mortality, including cardiovascular disease and cancer. So not only is TV violent, but it can kill you. In evolution, something went wrong. Horribly wrong. So what is the sweet spot? How much exercise should we get? Let me point something out. This is powerful. Take a look at those dots. When you increase your exercise from 30 minutes a week to 90 minutes a week, look at the decrease that you have in mortalities of all type, including cardiovascular. 90 minutes a week is 3 30-minute sessions. That's it. Now, if you increase it further to 3 hours per week, divided over the course of the week, you increase it, and then there comes a point where too much doesn't do anymore. Beyond 6 hours, doesn't really help out that much more. Now, exercise also has anti-inflammatory effects, very powerful. It decreases inflammatory cytokines and increases our anti-inflammatory cytokines. And it's good for sleep, too. People have found that the National Sleep Foundation says that if you're exercising 150 minutes per week, that significantly improves sleep for many, many different reasons. And it's good for restless legs. You know, so I will commonly tell my patients with RLS that they should namaste. Sometimes, however, they go, nah, I'm going to stay in bed. And then there's exercise and cancer. When you inject rats, mice, with melanoma, and you give one set an exercise wheel and another set that doesn't, 35% of the rats with the exercise wheel that got adequate exercise got cancer, as opposed to 75% of the ones that didn't exercise progressed on to cancer. So we need to start prescribing exercises. When you take a look at all of the benefits that it has, it's amazing. If you could package that and put it into a drug, it'd be like amazing. What about children? Children fidget. And you know what? That's neat. Non-exercise activity thermogenesis. The more that you fidget or you stand, you know, this is good. This is a really effective way of burning calories. It's an effective way of increasing your metabolism. Now, one of the problems is that we have a tendency to tell kids always to be still and then Ritalin them to still. So what can you do for your children to encourage exercise? This is a picture of my son when we did our first family 5K. He was in preschool at the time, and we didn't make him run the whole thing, just as much as you want. He's on my shoulders taking a look at the thousands of people that have come to one place for a common goal, you know, to exercise. And we had him, he had a superhero shirt, and his cousin had a Supergirl shirt, and everyone would clap them on, and that created him wanting to exercise during the week and practice. He calls it practicing a 5K, which every year we do one. This past year we did one at the Star Wars one, which was cool because we ran around with lifesavers. You know, we brought those ourselves. They didn't provide those. What about nutrition? So yes, we want to be fit, and as it said, it starts in the gut as well. You know, I had a big aha moment when I saw Dr. Joel Fuhrman's talk, and he came to Lee Health, and he put this slide. I didn't get the slide from him. I'd replicate it as best that I can, but he calls the standard American diet kind of the meat and sweet diet. And when the majority of your diet is meat and sweet together, the combination increases IGF-1. The insulin-like growth factor system has been implicated in the genesis of cancer, cardiovascular disease, and diabetes. So when we take a look at the healthy plate that we created as a stepping stone, as a start, if you're decreasing the meat and you're decreasing the sweet, you're reducing the IGF-1. And if you, 25% of your calories being from protein, plant-based proteins, or if you have animal to make it organic, grass-fed, wild-caught, as much as you can, and make sure that it's lean, this is helpful. But also take a look at the grains. Government told us a number of years ago that the majority of our diet should be grains. That's led to a number of different problems, and I'm not saying don't eat grains. Just like we take the meat in moderation, the grains are in moderation as well. So when I saw that slide, it made me realize really why any vegetarian study that you ever do is always going to be more successful than that of the standard American diet, because you're decreasing the meat, you're taking that part away, so you're not having that increased IGF-1. Excuse me. Sorry. So if 50% of your plate is veggies and fruits, that's healthy. Another option, you can have 75% of your plates be veggies and fruits, and you're eliminating the sweet part on a proper paleo plate. And I say proper because a paleo diet has been kind of mislabeled and miskewed to think that it's Fred Flintstone eating a brontosaurus burger that makes your car fall over. No, meat does not have to be bigger than the size of your fist. Part of the problem is that we have a lot of processed foods, so don't eat processed crap because that's going to increase your IGF-1. So what should you eat? You know, I mentioned different diets. Hey, make it simple. Just eat real food. Part of the problem is that we've gone from these traditional meals that were minimally processed, prepared at home, to these ultra processed products that are made to resemble food. We have gone from species diversity to product diversity. And the ultimate form of ultra-processed foods is fast food, which has increased from 2% to 20% in the children's diets in the 1970s, and it's infiltrated everywhere, including society, schools, playgrounds, and hospitals, but not at Lee Health. You won't find a McDonald's there. So what is this doing to the rate of nutrient digestion and absorption? It's increasing the glycemic load. It's increasing the glycemic index. So when you eat whole, fresh foods, you need your entire GI tract to absorb it. That's why it was made as long as it is. But when you're eating processed foods, the absorption just spikes and you get these spikes in sugar. Other things, you know, such as white bread or white rice, potatoes, this is also very high glycemic, and you get these spikes in sugar. So let's take a look at glycemic index and hunger, because if you're hungry, you eat more, right? So we took these, someone took these three different meals. They did a high glycemic breakfast, a medium glycemic breakfast, and a low glycemic breakfast. For the high glycemic breakfast, they gave them instant oatmeal. The quicker that it is to cook, the more processed that it is, the higher glycemic you have. They compared it to steel-cut oats, which preserve the kernel itself. And then they did a low glycemic meal of a veggie omelet. And take a look at the spikes that you get in the high glycemic meal. as opposed to the low glycemic. So I don't tell people not to eat oatmeal, but one thing that I say is when you're eating it, how long does it take to cook? Because we have to think about the glycemic index. Now, what goes up must come down, right? And take a look at how the sugars just drop around hour 4 and 5. Well, what's gonna happen? Now your epinephrine levels around hours 4 and 5 start to spike. I used to wonder as a child why, when I ate cereal and I went to school, why am I hungry? I ate breakfast, you know, how come I can't make it till lunch? Now we know why. And again, you know, government said eat 7 to 10 things of grains per day, and your low-fat bagel, or excuse me, your bagel with non-fat cream cheese, that's gonna affect your glycemic index. So what do you think is happening in schools where they give them the school breakfast of a Pop-Tart, and then a couple hours later, is that kid gonna be paying attention, or is the kid gonna be pulling a girl's hair? Yeah. Now, the hungrier you are, the more that you eat, and we can see that when people have high glycemic meals, they eat more, and guess what? Their choices aren't the best. They're not eating blueberries and nuts. They're going for that blueberry muffin that's sugar crusted on top. So let's take a look at the glycemic effects on the animal models. You know, I'm a scientist, so we have to have a knockout mouse in here somewhere. So when you give these mice one of two options, you're giving them the same amount of calories, the same amount of macronutrient proportions. The only difference is the glycemic index on the starch. They wanted to keep these mice at the same weight. And as you're looking on your left side over there, you could see that they accomplished that. They kept the mice at the same weight. But in order to do that, they needed to decrease the amount of food from the high glycemic index rats there. And the high glycemic rats, even though they weighed the same, their amount of adipose tissue or fat cells was higher. And you could see that the low glycemic had a lot more lean body tissue, whereas the high glycemic had a lot more visceral fat. So people, you know, have asked me, Cologne, you know, Dr. Cologne, why are you so obsessed with the glycemic index? You know, even sometimes my wife is like, I don't want to hear about it. Let me walk you through some biochemistry, and this will be a rapid walk through biochemistry, all right? Sugar, all right? So carbohydrates, glucose, can be absorbed throughout your body, 90% of your body, but fructose has to be absorbed through your liver. And table sugar has high fructose corn syrup has fructose, so obligatory, and it has to go through your liver. Isn't that where junk goes? Yes. And then when that happens, you form VLDL. What's that? It's fat. It's lipid. It's cholesterol. You know, so it's something called lipogenesis. Lipo means lipid. Genesis is making it in your liver. Well, that gives people fatty liver disease. And actually, the term foie gras is French for fat liver. And how do they make that? They overfeed ducks grains. They overfeed them. Well, when your cholesterol ends up high, you end up on a statin. Guess what? Statins can affect your mitochondria, which make energy. And then you have fatigue, and then they end up in my clinic. We've been snoring for 10 years, but now all of a sudden we're fatigued. It came around the time that we're on the statin. So cholesterol, you need that to make hormones. And then the statin blocks your making of testosterone. We end up with low T, we end up with fatigue, we end up in my clinic. Other pathways occurred that as you metabolize that sugar, you end up with increased uric acid. And guess what? That damages your mitochondria as well. You end up with fatigue. The uric acid disrupts your blood vessels, ability to make nitric oxide, and then this leads to high blood pressure. People say when you have high blood pressure to avoid salt, but it's the other white crystal that we have to be mindful about too. So we were taught in medical school that if you have high blood pressure, there are secondary causes such as a pheochromocytoma, but 90% of it is essential hypertension. Well, essentially, it's coming from our diet as well. And then you end up with high blood pressure, you end up on a beta blocker, and when you're on a beta blocker, that causes less melatonin secretion. Now you have insomnia, now we're in my clinic. And then there's all these pathways of insulin resistance. And then all that sugar diet ends up to high insulin resistance, which is a direct mitochondrial toxin. It affects your mitochondria. You end up with fatigue. We end up in my clinic. So when you end up with insulin resistance, you end up on metformin. Metformin is another mitochondrial toxic drug. What's it going to lead to? Fatigue. Insulin resistance leads to depression. Depression is associated with sleep disturbances. We're in my clinic. Then you end up with Alzheimer's disease because insulin resistance leads to Alzheimer's disease, type 3 diabetes, some people are calling it. Well, guess what? Insomnia and circadian rhythm disorders predate Alzheimer's by over a decade sometimes. And then in children, we end up gaining weight, and obesity has been associated with ADHD. Then they're in my clinic because we're trying to make sure that it's not a sleep disorder before we start a medication. And I'll say that this slide hits home to me because as a child, I was heavy, I was obese as a child, and during high school, I was diagnosed with ADHD. And it wasn't until a number of years later, through lifestyle changes and a regular practice of mindfulness, that I was able to overcome that ADHD. But then I said, we gain weight. So as you gain weight, you end up with obstructive sleep apnea. Once again, we're in my clinic. But then I've changed people's lives with CPAP. They feel like Superman sometimes the next day. But I have a select population that their sleep apnea is treated, but they're like, doc, why am I still fatigued? And we're on 5 or 6, 7 different medications that affect our mitochondria. And then this goes on further. Insulin resistance actually ends up leading to cancer, to tumorigenesis. So if foodborne illness, if sugar causes cancer or contributes to it, what if we were to take that sugar away? Yeah, some people have done it. And they've done these trials where they give one group of people a ketogenic diet, which is no carbohydrates, or I want to say no carbohydrates. I'm not anti-carbohydrate. I love carbohydrates in the form of plants, real whole fresh plant foods. So they gave ketogenic diets and eliminated the sugar, and they responded better to chemotherapy treatments than the group that just had the regular diet. Plus, they had less fatigue, and they had less insomnia as well. And I actually have a lot of experience with the ketogenic diet because my original background was in child neurology. And where I trained at Vanderbilt, we had a very active ketogenic diet program. And when I first started over here and opened up the neuroscience center, we started one as well. And very vigilantly, I checked these cholesterol levels. Why? Because if they're eating more fat, oh my God, I need to monitor their cholesterol levels. And I never understood why these kids would lose weight. Their lipid profiles would always improve while we were on it. We'll talk about the science behind that. I did mention this to an oncologist at one time, and the response was, well, but the ketogenic diet is not a sustainable diet. Why? Because it'll affect your heart? Actually, when cardiologists have studied it, they found that there's a decreased level of triglycerides, LDL cholesterol, blood glucose, and improved HDL. So let's talk more science. Let's talk mechanistic studies. So now taking a look at humans, not animal models. When you took some obese young adults and you gave them a couple different diets, one was a low-fat diet, another was low-glycemic, kind of like a Mediterranean diet, and then they gave another group a very low-carbohydrate diet. And what they're trying to do is monitor weight, but also monitor metabolism. You could see that the low-fat group had the lowest amount of metabolism. And this sounds contradictory. You know, wait a minute, fat has 9 calorie per grams, or a teaspoon of oil has 120 calories. That's true in a Bunsen burner if you're trying to elevate the temperature of water by 1 degree. But in your body, fats are metabolized more effectively. So long-term effects of micronutrients on weight. You know, so I do agree with what Dr. Chazal said, that we need more clinical studies. And here's one where they took a low-fat diet that met the criteria for the American Heart Association. And then they took a Mediterranean diet. And the Mediterranean diet was, overall low glycemic. And they emphasize, instead of meat, to have poultry or fish. And then they gave another group a low-carbohydrate diet. And in the low-carbohydrate diet, they counseled the patients for their protein and fat intake to be plant-based. Now, this is a feeding study that was done in Israel. In Israel, the main meal that they eat is lunch. So they provided the workers with lunch and one of these three criteria. And you can see that with all of the diets, they started to lose weight. The very low carbohydrate diet, they lost a ton of weight at the beginning. And then they started out at carbohydrates at just 20 grams per day and increased it to over 100, like 120. But overall, the Mediterranean diet and the very low glycemic diet had better continued weight loss than the low fat diet. So this concept of just eat less and you'll lose weight is a little bit of a misnomer. It depends on what you're eating as well, looking at your glycemic index. So what do I think about the glycemic index in children? You know, I just learned this past week, that metformin comes in a liquid. Why? Because kids can't swallow pills. And I learned this when I was seeing a six-year-old for sleep apnea that was on metformin, 6 years of age on metformin. You know, this isn't judgment, but honestly, what does the family think is going to happen? That you have diabetes just for a year in childhood and then you outgrow it? So when they give kids different diets, you know, and they tried to do low protein versus high protein, low glycemic versus high glycemic, they found that the protein really didn't influence the diet as much as the glycemic index. And the high glycemic low diet showed the greatest increase in adiposity, which is fat gain. And the low glycemic diet showed the greatest decrease overall prevalence of obesity and overweightness. Now, part of the problem is, again, we have these ultra processed foods. You know, this whole entire bowl of strawberries has the same calorie content as one pack of Gushers. So not all calories are the same, but energy density. The other thing is that whole bowl of strawberries has fiber that balances the sugar coming out, as opposed to these Gushers that they say it's made with real fruit just for marketing purposes. And when you look, it's fruit juice. They say there's vitamin C in there. Yeah, because it helps preserve it on the shelf. And when you're giving these incredibly intensely sweet things to kids, you're affecting that primordial palate. We were born to survive, and part of our survival in infancy is a preference towards really sweet, really salty, fat flavor of breast milk. But you eventually stop with the breast milk, and then your taste buds need to mature. And if you continue to give them that really sugary, ultra-processed, food-resembling product, just the thought of a vegetable becomes unpalatable. So what can you do to help kids eat their vegetables? So I went to my daughter's preschool on a different day, and I didn't go there to make silly faces, although I did. I did there to talk about phytonutrients. I had the kids say over and over again, phytonutrients, it's the colors within our veggies and fruits. And I gave them this kids' phytonutrient sheet from the Institute for Functional Medicine, where I told them to check every day, make sure that you have one of each color and put a check on it. And if you do that, hey, they're having 6 servings of veggies and fruits. The other thing that I taught them is when you do eat meat, it doesn't have to be bigger than the size of your fist. Get that in them early. Other things you could do, take them to a farmer's market. Help them pick out products. Have them name what the vegetables are. Grow some herbs and then use that into your cooking. Have them cook with you. You know, so my daughter helps me a lot. She helps me cook a lot. And I asked her one day, I said, Jada, are you going to be on Food Network one day? And she goes, no, I don't want to get chopped. But have them participate in the cooking process. Have them stir stuff. You know, sometimes it's not the most productive health, but you know, they're getting something out of it. They're more likely to eat what they're helping cook. You know, Jada always puts the turmeric on there. She loves to put cinnamon on the vegetables. Great, that's anti-inflammatory. So you could also hide some of the vegetables. This is a trick that I learned from Joel Furman. I have my organic beef there, and then I have the broccoli. I cut the broccoli stalks. I put that in the food processor. I sprinkle cumin and a little bit of garlic, and those little burger patties that you see are half broccoli. You know, so that decreases the inflammation. And then also, if you put avocado on that as well, that decreases inflammation as well. play with your food every now and then. So these are our palm trees for breakfast. That's chicken sausage instead of pork. And then we have, I give them more than just four orange slices, but you know, you gotta make it fun for them to take a look. And eat greens three times a day. That's Dr. Sebastian said. How do you get them to do that? Turn it into a game. So that's kale on the bottom. And the other day, you know, just about every day I have a bowl of kale with olive oil for breakfast. And I was gonna give some to my son, and he goes, yay, yummy kale. Well, that's the kind of nicknames that we have. We have yummy kale, delicious broccoli. Take them to a restaurant that doesn't have a children's menu. As long as they continue to eat mac and cheese, french fries, and chocolate sugar milk, they're never gonna develop the taste for vegetables. And if you go at a decent time that it's not busy, ask the chef, if, hey, can I take a tour of the kitchen? Can I expose my kid to cooking? Glorify vegetables. I said, young man, I love your broccoli shirt, and he likes that. Encourage exercise as well. This was a picture that my wife took from inside the house. He has to go play. You know what he's doing? He's doing some of the exercises that we do on Saturday or Sunday mornings. And also meditate with your kids. So, you know, this looks cute at first, you know, but it's actually initially sleep avoiding behavior. I said, they're in their pajamas. Kids, let's go to bed. They go, no, Dad, we meditate, you know. But as time has gone by, we continue to do this. And if you look, she's got her little, Jada has her little funky diva pajamas there and a little bit of toothpaste on her mouth before she goes to bed doing a little meditation. Because there's lifestyle daily choices that we make that influence our life. And there was no slide that I saw throughout all of our national speakers that made an impact on me more than this one here. So when you look at this on the surface, it says red, you know, mortality and cardiovascular disease and cancer. On the green, the amount of plant-based foods that you eat. And really on the surface, this says that nutrition is very important. It is, but it's more than that. And I say this because I've been to Laos, okay? I've been to Indochina where they did that study there. And throughout Indochina, as I'm walking through Laos, this is the serenity that I would see. And these are not Google images. These are pictures that we took. There is a calmness over there. Why? I've been to places where the right of manhood is to enter the military. But in Laos, the right of manhood is to spend time in the Buddhism temples and to learn meditation. And the monks, what would they eat? They would eat what the community is giving them. Community. Community is medicine too. Now, if you take and then afterwards, they would eat breakfast, they would eat lunch, and then they would fast intermittently. Intermittent fasting. I didn't have time to talk about that. If you look at the end of the line, there's little kid monks. Not chipmunks, but kid monks. And as you're going down the Mekong River, you see those kids playing. They're playing in the water. You know, you're supposed to be still when you meditate, right? But even monks realize kids have to move. And they laugh a lot too. This was our tour guide. The guy was hilarious. He was always laughing. He was a monk for 13 years, then realized he liked girls. Cool, I get it. And they cook real food. Look at all those phytonutrients. And it's not an exclusive vegan place. It's not a paleo place, definitely, because they eat rice as well, although they eat different things of rice. But the meat that they eat, it is small. You know, the portions are small, but the animal itself is small. You could tell that there's no antibiotics. You could tell that there's no hormones. Not only do they eat meat, they actually also eat the organ meats as well, whether it's liver, heart. And a lot of people will sneer at that. They'll be like, ugh. I mean, it is too paleo for me, but but it's rich in coenzyme Q10. We're prescribing a lot of coenzyme Q10, but they're eating it cheaply. And then there's a community, once again. So walking around Hanoi, I was amazed. I went for my morning jog and I was like, whoa, what's this? The entire community was out there doing different exercises. Some people were doing aerobics, elderly were doing Tai Chi, which by the way, that's evidence-based medicine, that Tai Chi and elderly reduces falls. What were the men doing? Some were jogging, others were working out, but you know what they had? They had stone weights. Each guy would bring their stone weights. They'd come to one corner and they would work out together. And where is Laos on the map? Let's talk about sleep. So there's Laos on the map. Look at this. Look at the light pollution. So they have low amount of light pollution, but what other color do you see? You see red. That red is fire, and they're not burning bushes. They're not burning their forests. That red is wood stoves or oil lamps. It's a decrease in electronics. So when you look at this and you say that this is only about nutrition, that's like comparing apples to rocks. It's about lifestyle. So Dean Ornish showed that with dietary changes, vegetarian diet, but also with aerobic exercise, smoking cessation, stress management, avoiding simple sugars, that you can reverse heart disease. Dr. Mark Hyman did a similar thing with the Daniel Plan, that he has a friend who's a pastor, and he was baptizing his community, and he said, wow, you know, my community is kind of heavy. So Dr. Mark Hyman reached out to them, and they worked together, and they did the same plan that Daniel did when the king told Daniel, eat my meat and ale, and Daniel said, hey, man, let me just have some veggies and water. And after 21 days, they were all healthier, and you could see that. So Dr. Mark Hyman comments that he wanted to call this the Jewish doctor's guide towards healthy Christian living, but they settled on the Daniel plan instead. By the way, two things. The Healthy Life Center, they have a book journal club or a book club. The Blood Sugar Solution is going to be their next book if you want to join that. But also, I did talk about eating healthy fats. It's important to learn about that. And a great resource is Eat Fat, Get Thin, where you can learn more about healthy fats. Dr. Terry Walls takes a paleo diet and reverses. I just got my 10,000 step. That is awesome. I once got my 10,000 step as I was walking to pour a glass of wine, and that was a double pump. So Dr. Terry Walls took a paleo diet, not just a paleo diet, but paleo plus. You know, so we're inducing nutritional ketosis. And once again, when people think ketogenic diet, they think tubs of mayonnaise. No, look at what she has there. A lot of plants that are above the ground plants with sprinkling of healthy fats, mostly plant-based as well. But it's not just about the diet. Her protocol also includes mindfulness. It includes detox, and it includes exercise as well. And what if you're in a wheelchair and you can't get up and exercise? You still exercise through neurostimulation, reversing multiple sclerosis. How much money has been spent on research for Alzheimer's for medications that does not alter the course, of which lifestyle can reverse Alzheimer's certain degrees through this MEND protocol? And it's a very strict protocol, very strict who they let in. If you're a smoker, you're automatically excluded. This is not judgment, this is fact. So in functional medicine, I have these scripts for different diets, for exercise, for different activities. Oh wow, look at that, Lee Health has that too, isn't that cool? And it's all on one, because it's what we're doing. We're taking a lifestyle approach to wellness and prevention through six focus areas, knowing that healthy lifestyle includes physical activity, nutrition, sleep, stress management, mental health, and our purpose. And when I put pictures of myself or my family, I'm not saying this is what I do or these are my preferences. Listen, I want to acknowledge that life is difficult. And I myself work probably around those 55 hours when you consider everything else that we do. But I'm just trying to show different things that you can do to incorporate in your lifestyle. Does this really matter? Does provider behavior matter? Well, yeah. Because physicians who exercise are more likely to counsel those to exercise. Physicians that engage in healthier foods are likely to counsel their patients to do that as well. That's evidence-based medicine, both of these things that I showed you there. I couldn't find evidence-based medicine that physicians who meditate are likely to pass that on to their patients. I have an N of one myself that I do incorporate this into my life as I do my practice as well. And yes, recently we were at the Healthy Life Center. So, you know, Dr. Sal was taking a question earlier, you know, did you learn about lifestyle through osteopathic medicine? And he made the comment that actually we learned it through different paths. You know, he learned it through the A4M. Heather and Teresa Spano worked together at the Integrative Medicine Center, and she learned it through a fellowship in integrative medicine. Sebastian and I are doing it through the Institute for Functional Medicine. And you know, to be transparent, I would like as many physicians to join one of these organizations to learn and spread the word there. And I'll even have some pamphlets on functional medicine if anybody wants them. So I want to thank you for your time, and remember that when we encourage others to encourage others, we make this world a better place. Thank you.